pressing and pressing. And sometimes we overtrain a muscle too much that you plateau on it or you damage it. So I asked God, what are we doing? So we got to a point of plateauing in the spirit. We're not increasing, we're not making change. We got to a place where we're just stagnant. We're looking busy. We have the sense like we're real busy, but we're not making real change. All we're doing is going through the motion. Now, I'm not saying the house of man is going through the motion. I'm saying that the body of Christ has been going through this motion for a long time. I said, well, how can we? Because it's one thing, the sons of Issachar in the Bible, they understood the seasons. They understood the seasons of time. We're supposed to understand where we're at. It's one thing that it's the middle of winter and you're trying to put seeds in the ground because you know nothing's going to happen. You have to discern the seasons of the time. And the reason is we need to know what God is doing or about to do. And I've heard many, many theologians say, you cannot know what God is going to do. Well, my Bible tells me that He gives us signs before the wonders. A sign is to tell us where we're going. Because we can get in our vehicle, I'm going to Corpus, but if you don't know where you're going, you're going to be lost. You can get in a vehicle, gas it all up, change all your oils, do all the oil pressure change, everything you want to do. Load up the car, you got DVDs because the kids are going to go crazy on a long drive. You know, you do the whole thing. But you get in the car, and if you don't know where you're going, you'll be lost. One of the most frustrating trips you'll ever take. Because you're lost. And you know, men know their way around anyways. They get wherever they're supposed to go. They never get lost. They never get lost. Because before there was a Tom-Tom, there was called a Mom-Mom. Mom-Mom was a GPS, it's the God positioning system, which puts in a woman, the woman knows where they're at all times. Men always feel like we're lost all the time. Now, for some of you men, I'm going to help you out here. I know we don't want to go ask for directions because we know inside the direction that God is leading us. And we're going there. But if we go this way to get there, I'm taking you on a scenic rock. I wanted to show you this house over here that looked beautiful. I was going to show you that over here, this land looked great. I know we wasted about 30 minutes on this trip, but I just wanted to spend time with you, baby. That's all. And then the GPS kicks in, call Mama. Mama says, would you just stop and go ask for directions? Okay. And then you stop. Okay? We go on a trip and a journey with God that sometimes we don't quite understand how we're going to get there. But the Bible tells me He gives us signs. He does give us signs. The problem is, are we sensitive enough to really pay attention to the signs? Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about your pastor, Marty. I need glasses for distance. So sometimes you think I'm getting a prophetic word. I'm trying to focus. If I get in a car and I'm driving, I need my mom, GPS, to tell me, what is that sign after? We're supposed to turn off on such and such road. And she looks at me like, you're telling me this now? Because that was past a couple of miles back. You're going to have to turn around. Now, thank you, Jesus. Why do you think we leave Thursdays to go to Houston? Because if I get lost, nobody knows but me. But if I can't see the sign, I will miss my turnoff, right? You may be going to Houston and wind up in, you know, in Galveston Bay. Well, we're going to have a revival here, not over there, right? Miss it. Just totally miss it. Because you didn't understand where you were going. You didn't find the directions beforehand, right? We didn't prepare. So I said, this is what I would tell you about me. I didn't prepare. And, you know, we get lost. But there's always a way to get back on track. Always. The way you get back on track is turning to someone for help. If you don't turn for someone to help, because, man, this is going to seem like I'm bashing the men movement, but I'm not. Because you know us, man, we don't want to ask for direction. We're never lost. We know where we're going. We're just going somewhere. We just don't know the direction. But we have a tendency not to want to ask for directions because of pride. See, y'all man looked at me like, man, that's it. Pastor, he ain't even outside. And women, I'm going to help you men out. Women think they got all the answers anyhow. See? But the operative word was think. So did Eve. In the garden, she thought she had all the answers. to leave it there because you mess with a woman, you're done. You're done. I look this way and I just thought, oh man. I know when Katrina starts taking off her eyelashes. When Katrina was about to start taking off her eyelashes, saying, son, you know, hold up. Don't let me turn to my favorite person. Medea has a tendency to want to make sure you're going to hear what she has to do. Why are you looking that way? That's my friend. My friend. Well, she's going to let you know she has something to say. And she ain't going to hold back. Right? Medea's going to let you know. And if you don't, she's going to make sure you have peace. Right? A piece of steel. It's really the lesson. Let me, okay, here we go. This would be at that point where we say, cut. I ask God, what is going on with the body? The Bible tells us that if we, as a people, don't have vision, we perish. Our vision has been skewed. The Bible tells us that the enemy will come in like an angel of light. His whole goal and purpose is to lead you by convincing you, by persuading you, to deceive you, to go astray. That's his goal. Yes. He can't do nothing physically to you. Let me just clear that up. The devil can't physically do anything to you because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Do you understand that? So whatever the enemy is lying to you about your health or what's manifesting in your home, it's a lie. It's deception. Do you understand? Yes. Now, with that said, when a devil tries to come to a, supposedly attack you, you have to remember who you are in Christ. Amen. When you can see the salvation of the Lord, when you understand that the blood of the Lamb Jesus was shed for you, you have victory already. He's just trying to deceive you. Okay? When your deception is taken, you go off course. It's very easy. Because when I get lost when I'm driving, I'm usually, wow, that's a nice building. Wow, did you see that car? I cleaned that truck in the name of Jesus. Yes. And my baby, she's, you know, she's in, you know, just for you to do a prosperous stuff. I'm like, how am I going to turn around now? Oh, I got distracted. How many times have we been distracted? Huh? Lots. Now, let's get out of the vehicle for a little bit. You get in your job. You get in your job, you can get distracted real quick. Real quick. Because I remember back in the day when I was starting to do construction and some trailers and getting them ready. And my dad happened to go do this one trailer. Oh, yeah, my salvation got tested real quick. When they say the fear is not of the Lord, that day I believe it was. Because these were abandoned trailers, and when you open up the door, the light would turn on. And you would see critters run all over the place. And we had to be the ones to clean it up. Ain't that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
We learned how to pray in tongues real quick. We weren't even baptized yet in the Holy Ghost. But real quick. And I thought, that's it, God, I'm through. Dude, I bind everything that's in here and they ain't moving. So I don't know if that's for real. Look at that. And then I happened to look in one corner. And it looked right back at me. And when it stared me down, it won. It won. Because you know when you shine a light and all of a sudden you see two red eyes? Okay, now I just got saved, guys. I just got saved. I thought I was ready to tackle any demon, any devil. And I thought I was really bad. You know, I'm going to go in there. Yeah. And then I ran across the room in the corner. I look and I see these red eyes. There went my flashlight and there I went. And then all you can hear, right? I said, well, why you got me here? Why you got me doing this? I am the head, not the tail. I am above and not beneath. He says, son, would you just get in and do your job so you can get paid? Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, Jesus, this isn't right. This isn't God. I'm out here in the heat. There's no cold water. Why am I in here? And then you finally get enough strength and you go in. I looked at Alan. I said, Alan, I feel like there's fleas all over my legs. Is there? And he looked at me. He says, you're covered in them. Oh! Do you remember that one? Oh, we have stories. So I thought for sure I was way off track. I thought I made a detour somewhere. Maybe I'm not supposed to do this job. Maybe I'm not supposed to. And I said, no. See, you read my sign correctly. Go in this direction. But you thought that once you got there, that was going to be it. That things were going to change immediately for you. But you didn't know that what I was going to show you was something to teach you for the future. Well, how are you going to do that with all these fleas? That big old thing is in the corner looking at me still. He says, you got to understand, I'm going to put you in circumstances that you may not like, but you're going to learn from it.
Amen.
You didn't detour. You actually went right in the same direction I told you to go. But my eyes would have told me I'm in the wrong place. My flesh said, this isn't God. My flesh said, there's no way you're going to put me in a flea-infested, trailer. And it had some, these weren't the little, these were the big ones that you see out in the field that you have to, with 22, you have to shoot the big. And it didn't move. It just stared you down. This is not God. It didn't look like God, and it was God all along. Let me fast forward a few years. Alan and I go ahead and start a little minor construction business. And we go and paint houses, and we do some minor work. And this is why I learned it. No. Now, your flesh made you detour. You wanted to do something based on what you learned then, but I'm still trying to show you something for a bigger picture. Now wait on me. Let me wait on you. I gotta feed my family. I gotta do what's right, because the Bible says those that don't work will not eat. Because if I would have said a man that don't work is Yahweh, okay, you would have pointed back to the man. But we're mankind. That means all of us, right? So I had that scripture thrown at me from every Christian that I ran into. Are you working? You got a job? I don't know what God's doing, man. I ain't got nothing. Well, you know what? You're in sin because you ain't working. You're the provider of the house. What? Right? We all have Medea in us. We do. Because I remember back then when I used to be accused of that. I said, well, you're just lazy. You don't want to work. If I put an application at Burger King and they don't want to hire me, that's not, I try. But if you put your application on every place that you can think of and everywhere you're willing to work and the door don't open, that has some type of sign for you that God wants to do something with you alone. Because you're trying everything to get out. Everything. But God wants to get you to a certain place. And he was showing me, can you still keep your eyes on me even what it looks like around you? That's the tough part. That's the tough part. People without vision will perish. They will. So when I asked God about this scripture that I just couldn't get away from, he showed me. Go to 1 Samuel 3. 1 Samuel 3. And we'll start at verse 1. Are you there? Say amen. First Samuel 3. Now let me kind of give you a quick little Bible study on this. Samuel was the first prophet in the office prophet. Prophecy had been on the land before. Prophecy had been spoken through the men of God. The only difference is that Samuel became the office prophet for Israel, for the chosen people of God. Samuel was born from a woman called Hannah. His mother was Hannah. Hannah means favor. Hannah was also the second wife of a high priest. The second wife, which was Hannah, was barren, meaning her womb was shut up from God. She could not have babies. She couldn't bear any children. Hannah goes before the Lord in praise, as they would continually to make sacrifices unto the Lord. She would go and she prayed. Now, the priest that was there at the tabernacle, at the church, at the front door, would always come to her and see her. This time, he sees something different in Hannah. Hannah goes now to the altar by herself after making the sacrifice, and she prays. She prays from within. That the high priest looks at her and sees her lips moving, but hears nothing come out, and perceives her to be drunk, and says, why do you come here with having strong drink, or much wine. And he touches her lips. That was an indication that the Holy Spirit was already moving within Hannah. Hannah was beginning to intercede for her belief to have a child. But she didn't ask for just any child. She asked for a son so that the son can be used in the tabernacle, the church, the kingdom, can be used in the Levitical priesthood. She prayed specifics. Do you understand? This is what Hannah did. She didn't pray, just give me any child. Give me a son so he can be dedicated unto you in your service. Sometimes we are going to be like the disciples and say, Jesus, teach us how to pray. Teach us how to pray. Because we can pray and pray and pray and never get to the specifics that we need when we're praying. We're praying amiss. Hannah knew what she needed. Hannah knew what she wanted. And she prayed for a son. And if God would give her the son that can be used for the kingdom of God, she would then give her son to God. Now here we are in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 1. We fast forward a bit. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord before Eli. Eli was the high priest. And a word from the Lord was rare in those days. Say rare.
Rare.
A word from the Lord was rare. Now, if it's one thing you have people come to you and speak to you and just talk to you, their emotions, their feelings, or this is what I feel is going on in your life, this is what I feel. But when the word of the Lord comes, you know it's God because it's confirming to what's already in your spirit. So if it was rare, it's something that you're going to see begin to unfold here. Visions were infrequent. Visions. Now I know when we get here on Wednesday nights, and some of y'all on Sundays too get visions, and we get them all the time. All the time. And they're very confirming to what's going on in the spirit. But in this time, it was very rare. God would use certain events, or he would speak himself to the people. Now here we are. This is now in the church. Now I want you to understand that this is in the church. Watch this. It happened at the time as Eli was lying down in the place, in his place. Now his eyesight had begun to grow dim, and he could not see well. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. That the Lord called Samuel, and he said, Here I am. Then he ran to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call you. Lie down again. In other words, Samuel heard something. He didn't know what he was hearing, but he heard someone call his name. Gets up and runs to Eli, the high priest. Says, Here I am. Eli looks at him and says, I didn't call you. Go lay down. Goes again. Goes and lays down. Let me show you where they were actually at. Samuel, a young boy, is in the tabernacle. He is in the place where the Ark of the Covenant is. You know what the Ark of the Covenant is? Yes? Okay, the Ark of the Covenant is a place where God is, where he dwells. It's behind the Holy of Holies. In other words, there's a veil that separates. The veil hadn't been torn yet. Okay? Now the young lad, this young boy, Samuel, is already serving in the priesthood, which he shouldn't be doing. But because Hannah prayed, God answered, at a very young age, he's already ministering. Guess where he's ministering at? In the Holy of Holies. Do you understand? That's the closest you can get to God, is in the Holy of Holies. Because there's a veil that separates you from the others. So he's already there. He's lying down. Because, did you read another verse that the lamp had not gone out yet? That's the menorah. And that lamp had to be refilled every day. And there was a time frame that it was about, the oil was about to go out, and they had to refill it. Now both of them, the high priest, which is Eli, is on the outside of the tent. Actually, he's outside the covering of the veil. And he's lying there asleep. His vision is already gone. It's going dim. And what happens, if you can just see this, is that in the church, we have the priesthood, and we have the elders of the church that are going to sleep and not looking for what's coming or what's taking place in the church. And when the vision is being waxed dim, we need the light of God, the illumination of God, not to go out, but to increase. If we don't have the vision, we will perish. And sometimes we get put in darkness that we can't see where we're going. And if we can't see where we're going, sometimes we have to turn to somebody and say, I need help. But if I don't turn to somebody, the other thing you can do is turn to God. I need you to guide me, for you're the light in my darkness. Eli is waiting on the outside of the veil. Samuel is on the inside of the veil. Lays back down. He hears it three times. He hears him call him three times. And he goes to Eli. Finally, Eli says, wait a minute. Three times? Have I come to you? Did you call me? No, go lay on the floor. Okay. Must be going nuts. Ate pizza late last night again. Yes, here I am. By the second time, you're going to say, boy, what's up with you? How come you just can't sleep? What's going on? Because, you know, if your kids come to you twice, you know there's something going on, right? Because if your kids come to your bed, you hear them walking to your bed, and you're ready up. What? What happened? What's wrong? Or if you hear your kids coughing, for some of us will get up and play doctor. Others will sleep through it, not know anything happened last night. But then they go in the restroom and they see the bottle of Tylenol and or, you know, whatever, and they, what happened? Well, you know, one of the babies were sick. Well, how come he didn't wake me? Well, I, you know, or tried to hit me with the pillow and everything, he wouldn't wake up. I kicked the bed and everything, he still wouldn't wake up. Some sleep hard, right? But you know, if your kid is in trouble, comes up to you, and you can ask, what's going on? Eli did it. And this is what I want to show you. The high priest, this is a young boy, is already in the Holy of Holies doing one of the most important duties in the tabernacle. Is making sure that the light don't go out. Do you understand? Because when you make sure that the light don't go out, you're able to see where you're going. And illumination and revelation of the word comes to you. But as it's going out, it's the duty of the elder, the chief priest, the high priest, to train up that child. So by the third time, he says, Eddie and I, for the Lord is speaking to you. The next time, say, here I am, for your servant is listening. So here we go. Now the fourth time, he hears the call. Verse 4, the Lord called Samuel, and he said, here I am. Then he ran to Eli again, and here I am for you, call me. But he said, I did not call you, lie down. So he went and lay down. The Lord called yet again Samuel. Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you have called me. But he answered, I did not call you, my son. Lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord yet been revealed to him. Can you see how there is someone that's very young in the Lord? Very young. Did not know the Lord. Did not know anything, right? But he's already in the service in the Holy of Holies because of the prayer of the mom. Do you understand? Don't miss the fact that Hannah prayed, and exactly what Hannah prayed is happening right now. Verse 8, so the Lord called Samuel again for the third time, and he arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli discerned, by the third time he finally discerns, he discerned that the Lord was calling the boy, and Eli said to Samuel, go lie down. It shall be if he calls you that you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. How many of us are saying that to God right now? Are we telling God, speak? I am your servant. I am listening. Are you willing to be used of God? Or do you want to go through the motions again? And do you want to stay where you've been? I don't know about you, but I know church looks good. It looks fine. But I want so much more. Amen. Do you want more?
Yes.
Has he been making you hungry for more?
Yes.
Have you been lying down, waiting on God? Because he calls you, you get up, but you ain't seen nothing change yet, right?
Amen.
That's right.
Is he creating a hunger?
Yes.
How do you create hunger? When he removes himself from you. You understand, we are in a season and time where God is doing great things in different places. But there is a time when God says, let me see how much longer you're going to pursue after me. Let's see how much longer you're going to continually seek me in prayer and getting in your word. For some of us, I've said it many times, I don't like to read my word all the time. But ever since Father's Day, I've been in that word every single day. I don't know what the reason is for Father's Day. All of a sudden things change. Maybe I became a father. And I I started listening to the voice of God, what I needed to do. And because I started listening, that hunger was there. So I said, God, then teach me more. Teach me more. Samuel was beginning to listen. Once he began to listen, now we're going to see what's taking place. Verse 10, then the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. Did you see that? Samuel, Samuel. Guess who's speaking there? Is that the Lord God or the Lord Jesus? It's Jesus speaking from heaven now. Because you'll find in the later Gospels that when he speaks to the people, he won't even say, Martha, Martha, Mary, Mary. He's speaking then now. He comes onto the scene in verse 10. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I am about to do a thing in Israel, in which both ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. In that day I will carry out against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house, from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knew, because his sons brought a curse on themselves, and he did not rebuke them. Can you underline, he did not rebuke them, in your Bible? It's not sacrilegious to write in your Bible. You should be writing in it and making your own notes. What I want to show you here is that God is speaking to another generation and speaking concerning of the previous generation, which is Eli, the priesthood, the Levitical priesthood. As he's speaking to him, he's saying, I'm going to bring judgment on the house. Told you, I asked God, what's happening? What's happening? God will judge the church first. When he judges the church first, then the world gets judged in the natural. Do you understand? We've been taking this thing backwards and looking at, well, there's a famine in the land because of all this economy that's happening. There has been a drought in the spirit for a long time. And it hit the land. And the people are crying out now. But the people are crying out for shepherds with vision. Shepherds with vision. Not just a shepherd that wants to come in, make you feel good for the day, take your money, and say, we'll see you later. That's not a shepherd. That's a thief. If that shepherd is not concerned about your well-being, about your spirit, about your destiny, your purpose, and your gifts, that shepherd is in it for a business. I heard God tell me this, and I said, Lord, for me to minister this in the church, what kind of retaliation is going to come my way? He says, if you deny me and my word before men, I'll deny you before my Father. Oh, God, why are you talking to me like this now? I thought I knew what I was supposed to do. And then all of a sudden, I got this vision. I was right back in the trailer again. Do you see what I mean? It may not look like him, but he put me in a position that I had to learn for the greater good. We are going through a season in the church as a body of believers, that we need vision. If we don't have the vision of where we're going, we'll never make it anywhere. We'll be stuck in where we're at. We can't be stuck. We can't be stuck. I remember that movie with Joe Pesci, my cousin Benny, where the car gets stuck in that mud and the wheel keeps spinning and spinning. And it's kind of like that. We get in that rut and we can spin on our wheels, but we can never move forward. We can never get out of our rut. We just keep going and just burning our gas. And you can never do anything. All it does, guess what it does? The more you rev your engine and move your parts begin to get worn out. That's your engine. Your motor will go out and burn out because the RPMs are so high. You'll redline and it'll freeze up on you. Kind of like how the body of Christ did. We were pushing for so hard to get to a certain place for so long. And the next thing that happened is we got burnout. And when we hit burnout, we begin to see preachers begin to shut their churches because they got burnout and there's no more agreement with the spouse in the church. You see divorce going rampant in the church, which it shouldn't be. You should see that there's going to be an agreement in the church, but you weren't seeing the agreement. Because the father, the head, the high priest, was losing vision for the family. And we saw for many years how fathers were turning away from their children and doing their own thing and pursuing their own jobs and their own careers so that they could better support the family, but yet they're not in the house to support them spiritually. And we saw for a long season now where many children were running away from home. And we had a lot of people going in and trying to get into this whole cult thing with being a wolf and wearing these fake tails and thinking because they had identity issues that nobody loved them. Because the fathers weren't in the place to speak life to them and to encourage them and to tell them the good things that they are inside of them. And not to bash them because they're in the way. Children are a blessing of God. They're not some obstacle for you to say that you're in my way. I'm trying to get to over there. Children are put in your life as a blessing. And what took place is the fathers turned away from the children. And in that season, we saw so many crazy things happening. That teenage suicide was going through the roof. People were turning to things that were not of God. But until the fathers of the kingdom will turn unto the children and speak life and ask for forgiveness and let that pride go, we'll see a total restoration back in the home. And if you can get one home saved, you can save those that are connected to that home. You know how? Because we got to do it one at a time. You can't change a whole tribe of people. Moses tried it and he went nuts. He loved the people enough to say, God, just don't kill them. Do you understand? But it one at a time. One at a time. If we can get to one family household, and we can put order in one house, those that are connected to that house will see the order. They'll see the favor that is on that house because of order. And I've said this, and I'll say it to the day that I go home to be with the Lord. The mandate order of God is God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, man here on earth, then the church. You don't put ministry above your wife, your husband, or your children. That must be in order first before you can ever go do anything for the kingdom of God. I want to be a missionary. I want to go do missionary work. Start in your own soil first. Because your own soil really is your foreign soil. Because you haven't been there tilling it for a long time. Amen. So that when you're able to begin to speak life into your children, to your children's children, and then to your brothers and sisters, you'll begin to see change. The vision needs to come back to the head of the house, the head of the church. Where is the church going? Are we going away from the cross? Are we going away from Jesus? Then that's a sign and no wonder why this world is going to hell. Do you understand? If you take God out of the school system, then you're going to ask, why is a Columbine shooting? And why are all these shootings? And why are all the killings? And why are all these teenage pregnancies and all of a sudden teenage suicides? Why? Because you've taken the only thing, God, out of church. You take it out of this nation, guess what's going to happen? I was going to church. That's right. I'm sorry. I said church.
Yeah.
Maybe I was saying that. Maybe I was saying that. If you take God and Jesus out of the church and you look at it just for a personal gain, it reminds me of many prophets that I saw on TV years ago. Stand in line right here and bring your offering unto me. If there was someone giving $5, you got a $5 prophecy. But if someone was given $1,000 to $5,000, they got about an hour worth of prophecy. Yeah, and they would say, you want to be blessed? You give me this amount of money and send it in the mail. Do you remember that?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Where did the church grow from there? We're a bunch of fruits and nuts is what happened. Because it got very crazy. I had a dream. And in this dream, the church was a mess. A mess. And I said, Lord, what is going on? Guess what? It wasn't this church that I can see to be this physical church. It was a church and it looked like it was a circus. Because I remember walking out, and this is what I remember. I remember turning to my left to walk out to go in ministry, and there was this curtain. And as I was getting ready to open up the curtain, you know that how they played that tune for the circus? I don't know how it goes, but that one, okay? I heard that, and when I opened it up, it was like I was looking outside, and there was tents over here, and it had all these animals over here, and it had people walking around, And then, you know, the next thing I saw is when I looked right down the middle, I saw all these camera crews just running around to get their cameras and get everything. And then one guy came up to me and says, "You need to get your keys back." And then I woke up. Now, here's the crazy thing. I ate pizza that night. I did. And I said, "God, it was the pizza. It was the pizza." He said, "No, you know this from me." I got scared thinking this is the way my church was. That's when I was like, "God, I don't want to offend you. I don't want to do anything to displease you. Is this my church?" He says, "No, that's my church." I was like, "Oh my God." So I've been praying and praying. "God, what is it? What is it? Why?" We've made church a spectacle. And in the church, we've taken God out. I guess that's why it did come out that way. But I didn't mean to say school. But we took God out of church. Now, of course, I'm not talking about here. Because you can walk into the house and you can feel the presence of God. And if you can't, that's okay. But you'll learn to feel it. But as a prophetic voice right now, I'm speaking for the body of Christ. And your prayer should always be to lift up the heads of the church.
Yes.
Pray them through. Lift up the heads of the government and pray them through. And it don't have to be a long prayer. God help them. God help them. If we lose sight and lose focus on where we're going, we will get lost and we will be detoured. And we cannot be detoured. The vision has to come back. And the vision is to get the gospel to those that are lost. And there's a lot that sit in the church that are lost because they've been led astray by false doctrines, false prophets. Sorcery and witchcraft sits amongst us in the church. My Bible tells me that when you deal with the Jezebel spirit in Revelations, when you deal with it and you cast her out, that the crown of glory that is given to you as a church is greater than all the others.
Amen.
So if a Jezebel wants to come in, I'm talking about the house of man. If a Jezebel wants to come in and try to bring deception, division, and usurp authority, we as a body must recognize. Because if we were to see a herd of swine coming, that's pigs, run through this church, I know all of us are going to get them out, right? Well, it's the same thing about demonic spirits. Don't fear them. Get rid of them.
Amen.
Get rid of them. You have the dominion over them. We're not going to allow all this type of witchcraft that comes into the church as a body and expect for us to get major breakthroughs. God brings us and equips us for the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news, is we have dominion and power over serpents. That we tread upon them. We tread upon them. That means we walk on them. They don't walk on us. We walk on them. The gospel is healing the sick, not making them sick. You heal the sick. The Bible says in James that those that are afflicted among you, bring them before the elders of the church. Anoint them with oil and pray the prayer of faith so that they can be healed. There's many, many religions that don't do that. But they're going door to door. They're going door to door. And they want to let you know about their beliefs. But we as a Christian body that hold the truth and hold the power, the Holy Spirit is the power within us, and yet we're not witnessing to people. Do you understand? There's Jehovah's Witness and the Mormons are going out there every day. And I tell them, "You know what, I honor what you do. I do. Because your diligence, your consistency, and the word that they know about our Bible so much. Little skewed. Truth of the matter is, if you deny Jesus Christ and the resurrection power, then you're not believing in the gospel. You're creating your own gospel. That's the honest truth. Jesus did not say, "I am the truth, the way, and the only way to the Father." I don't read any other books that say that. Any other type of religions that say that. Their religion is I serve God, which is Allah. You serve a God, but you just go through Jesus. How about let's serve Allah and God, which are the same, and we'll call it Chrislam. Really? That's out there. It is. Chrislam, where the Islamic and the Christians will worship together towards God and then eliminate the source to God, which is Jesus. Did you see the light go out? When the light begins to go dim, it's easy. It's easy to follow anything that looks like light. Do you understand? He will come in like the angel of light. Like. And we will be deceived. The easiest way to see. Do you believe in Jesus?
Amen. Yes.
Then that's Christendom. That's kingdom. If the answer is no, I don't believe in Jesus, well then let me get you saved. There's a reason why we have to take the gospel to the people. You know why? Because there's only one true way that you're ever going to make it. It's through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because if you don't believe in Jesus Christ, you die in your sin and keeps you separated from God. But the moment that you accept Jesus Christ, you're right there in the Holy of Holies in His presence. That's how simple it is. But the light that is trying to come into the churches is trying to lead us astray. And you know what that light will use? Religion. Legalism. Condemnation. You know why religion? Because you do things on a religious mindset and never be free. They'll use condemnation because you can't always walk it all the way out by yourself. And the reason why you can't is because you have to lean on God. But he'll use condemnation and see, you're still struggling with this. You still continue to do these things, or you still continue to be this way. I use that condemnation to keep you away, and you choose yourself to get away from church. That's condemnation that doesn't come from God. God does not condemn you. You condemn yourself, and the devil condemns you. If you think, well, I messed up this week because I was doing this, or I had happy hour over here, I had happy hour with. How did you mess up? Really, how did you mess up? Did you denounce Jesus Christ? Did you say, I don't no longer believe in Jesus Christ? Did you give up your salvation by saying, I don't believe in Jesus Christ anymore? Did you do that? No. But the devil's going to make you think because the things that you were doing in your everyday life that you messed up and that you don't deserve the saving grace of God. That's a lie. That's called the accuser of the brethren, which is you. Condemnation has to be done away with. To give you liberty and freedom to go before the King of Kings. That's why the veil was ripped. So that there is no more condemnation and you can enter in as you are today. He made access for us. But what happens is when we have someone come in, and it's usually a person that wants to teach you a doctrine that is not of God. A certain belief or a certain system. And he'll lead you astray. He'll lead you right out to church. And guess who goes with them? Not the little body. Usually the leaders go. You know, how come I can say that? Because the Bible teaches us about the authority that is asserted when Jezebel goes against the authority and makes Ahab, her husband, submit to her. He was the king. She was the queen. That authority was flipped. You must know and understand the authority of the house. Jesus reigns and reigns forever.
Amen.
And when the shepherd can submit to that authority, then the body learns to submit to God. It's very important that we understand that the vision, the light cannot go out. If the light goes out, we'll miss the greatest harvest that's coming our way. Are we going to get past the past, the area of our life where we're tired of spinning our wheels? And if we are as a body, we'll get there. We'll get there. As long as we can lean on one another. Why? Because strength comes in numbers. If it didn't, Jesus would have never said, one can put 1,000, but two can put 10,000. You want to fight demons by yourself, guess what's going to happen? They're going to come knocking at your door. They will. How about getting with a group of believers to help you in this fight. And if they want to come your way, then you just take them out. But remember back in a couple of times, I would say I would go mess with the bee's nest, and I would get stung. No fault of anybody but my own for messing with them. That's what happens to a lot of people with zeal. That's the fire of God. I've got fire, I'm running out there, and then they trip and fall, and they burn themselves. They didn't use wisdom. You need to have wisdom, and you need to have the zeal of God together. And they go hand in hand. Because if I was to give you an adult, a vehicle, without the keys, you couldn't use it. But if I give you the keys and the vehicle together and don't put no gas in it, you can have the vehicle, but you still can't use it. Everything has to line up, and everything has to be in order for it to be used of God. Everything. And that's what I see that the body of Christ is beginning to do, is to come in alignment. And I believe that the greatest harvest that we're going to see of the souls that are coming into the kingdom of God and those that are sitting in the churches today are going to be revived, and revival is going to break loose. When the revival breaks loose, it's because we've got in line and in order, precept upon precept. And you understand, when we can do that, God can say, I can trust you. I can trust you because you understand that you won't separate from my cross. You won't separate from my son Jesus. You'll always look to him. Always look to him. And it's not on your own strength or your own power, but by the will of God and the presence of God. Amen?
Amen.
Do you want your light to go out?
No.
Then I pray right now, in the name of Jesus, that God's everlasting light be in you. Everlasting light. The presence of Almighty God and the illumination of his word be within your spirit and your soul. Let the presence of Almighty God continue to increase in your life. Let that hunger inside of you draw you closer to God. Closer to God and not away from God. That anything that is an antichrist spirit that wants to take you away from God, that you recognize. That you discern. And that you can understand the times so that you can move forward in God. But we thank you for the illumination of your word. Your presence, and the illumination of who you are. You're omniscient, Lord. You know everything. You're omnipresent. You are everywhere. And God, we thank you for guiding us through. We thank you in advance, God, for not letting the light grow dim and getting us in our rightful place as the high priest learns to seek God for the vision of the house and for the kingdom of God. Lord, we thank you in advance. We send forth this word into the atmosphere even now that the angels of Almighty God hearken unto the word and bring it to pass in the lives of your people, God.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name. All of God's children said amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All right, it's 12:15. I don't want to go too long. We have baptism tonight. What I wanted to get across to you is that we cannot let the light go out. We've got to keep vision, and we've got to have an understanding of where God is taking us. Once we understand where we're going, we'll make sure we don't get detoured. Amen?
Amen.
And if you feel like you're getting detoured, ask for directions. How do you do that in the spirit? Hey, this was presented to me. What do you think? Bring it before the church. Bring it before the church. If it doesn't line up with the word of God, that's how you know. That's how we know. In these last days, I know that the revival is going to be big. Big. Many prophets are talking about it. Many. And they're talking about this revival that has never been seen before. Never. The Bible talks about it in Joel chapter 2. Then in the last days, he's pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. That his sons and daughters shall prophesy. Young men shall have dreams. Women shall have visions. We need to continue to have the visions and the dreams. We need to. We don't need to have the dreams where you're eating late at night and you can't even get the understanding of what the dream is. I'll just tell you right now, put the pizza down. Don't be eating at 12 o'clock at night. So, I couldn't sleep, the devil tormented me. No, that was the pizza. And if you're like me that likes to eat and spicy stuff, That's not the fire of God. That's the jalapenos. I know. I can discern the difference. Can you? Huh? For some of you that really like the Tabasco sauce and everything like I do, put it on your cereal when you eat it late at night. Gotta understand, guys. Gotta understand. Is that God is trying to get us to a place in Him so that we can see progression in Him. When we got to that place of plateau, we were getting on the way up to the mountaintop. And we happened to turn around and look down to see the greatest victories that He's given us. But there's still more ahead of us.
Amen.
He doesn't quit fighting for you because you learn how to fight. He just lets you fight some battles. And the ones that you don't know about are the ones that He's fighting.
That's right.
Do you understand? For some of us, we've been spared many times over.
That's right.
Sometimes we got away from things that we didn't even know was coming our way. We got away from it. Because He's fighting the battle for you.
Amen.
See, that's why it's so important to understand that God is in control.
Yes.
When we surrender our will to Him, He takes over. But if you want to be the one in control, and you want to be like the man that gets behind the wheel and not know where he's going, and just keep driving, and when you run out of gas, and you want to get mad at everybody else but yourself, be efficient. Be efficient. And know where you're going. Know the signs to determine the times. Amen? Hallelujah. Simple, easy, to the point. If you want a deep revelation from God to understand where all this was coming from, you ain't going to know what to do with it anyways. What for? Well, what was the Hebrew word for that? It was simple. Blind. The light was going dim. You know how simple we can really make it? Turn off the lights, huh? Both lights. I can't see whether you're looking at me. I can't see whether your eyes are closed. I can't even see whether or not you're making faces at me. Or you're mocking me, doubting me, or not believing in me. I'm still trying to adjust to the darkness. Turn the lights back on now. But when the light comes back on, things in the Word become illuminated so that you can see. And you can have an understanding of what you see. When Jesus went to heal the blind man, not the one blind Bartimaeus at the pool, but the one who had to spit in his eyes, put the mud over and remove. Then he says, what do you see? I see men walking like trees. The blind man had an understanding of what he heard, but he didn't have an understanding of what he was seeing. So he had to do it again. Not to say that God can't touch you more than once. The first touch was the salvation. The second touch was the clarity and understanding of who Jesus Christ is. So that you can understand where you're going. You get put in darkness, you're going to want to know. You're going to want to know what's around you, especially if you're spooky. Because there's some people that don't want to go downstairs and go get a drink of water if all the lights are off. Because all of a sudden you're getting goosebumps all over you. But there's a demon. No, it's because you're fear. I heard something downstairs, Mom. What did you hear? I don't know. Something was, it was like loud. Was it like this? Yeah. That was your heart because you were scared.
Don't.
Well, I couldn't breathe. Were you going downstairs and all the lights were off? Yeah. But you were scared. You started hyperventilating. Not everything is a demon. Some of it is our own fear. And then God forbid you go downstairs and you got shoes all over the place. People just... Then you fall on the floor. That devil pushed me, Mom. No devil. We're going to bind that devil that don't want to take those shoes up to your closet. That's the devil.
Amen.
I was gonna go to part two, but I can't get there yet. Blind Bartimaeus was a blind man that was at the pool of Bethesda. Jesus walks by. The greatest thing about that story that I love, not that he cried out more, not that he was yelling at him, trying to get on his nerve, is that he told his disciples, go get. Go get. He should have never had to tell the disciples, go get. They should have just brought them. They had already seen all the miracles taking place. They had already seen what he could do. He had already healed the blind, the sick. He said, just go get. And then he brings them, what do you want? What do you want? Can we get on some people's nerves and say, I need God so bad? I need God so bad in my life right now. There's some people that just want to keep you quiet. You need to hush. All that praise that you're doing and dancing with the tambourines, you need to just sit down because we don't do it like this. Oh, no. You don't understand. I got to praise God for something because I know what he's done for me. No, you need to sit down because we don't do that in this church. No, you don't understand. I am the church. You don't understand. You can't sit me down when God is moving inside of me. No, you know what? You're not even a member of this church. You need to say, no, you don't understand. I am a member of the family, though. You understand? It's when you can get in some people's face, because we can get in people's face all the time, right? Sometimes I'll be like, hey, back off, man, back off. But when sometimes somebody wants to come and say, look, man, I just want to praise God, but you can't praise him like that. You don't understand what he's done for me, right? And I'm going to thank him the way I need to thank him. Because when I was out in the world, I wasn't out there just being quiet in the world. I was out there acting a fool in the world. And when I was acting a fool, sometimes some jokers wanted to come and take me out. But I had to bow up to kind of protect myself. Now that I don't have to do that, and God protects me, oh, you better just step aside. If you don't like my praise, you might want to go to the back of the room. Because I'm going to praise God with all my might. And I may lose my natural mind. I may have to lose my weave. I may just have to let it all loose. Because I remember back in the day, we get down and we break down real good. And if all of a sudden the music started to go up and you hear ranchera songs going on, yee-haw! Why? Oh, because we were happy. But we can't come to church and do the same thing? Amen. You don't understand where God brought me from. But I don't understand where God brought you from either. But God knows where he brought you from. Your praise is for him, not for us. So I know that when I had that gun pointed at me and they were about to shoot because I didn't want to do the cocaine, I said, you know what, just pull that trigger. Pull it. I want to die. Pull it. The guy looked at me, boy, you crazy. Yes, I am. And when I got saved, God took me right back to that same thing. He says, why not be crazy like that for me? I saved you. I was right there with you. I opened his eyes to see something. I didn't know why he left. He left with the drugs staying right there. I know that when I come into the kingdom of God, and I want to thank him, he didn't take me out numerous times. Numerous times. When I thank him like that, let it get on you. Let it get on you. I'm here to tell you, if we can just praise God and lose our natural mind, the supernatural power of God will flow through you and bring deliverance for somebody else. Amen. It's not about you being holy. He's holy. He's holy. It's about you just loving God. That's it. He'll do the rest with you. He's not telling you to be perfect. Did he tell you to be perfect to come into the kingdom? Did he tell you? Did he tell you? He didn't tell nobody. He just said, come. That's all he said. Amen. Come into this marvelous light and have eternal life. Now I don't fear. And I don't walk in fear. You shouldn't either. If I was to tell you that I'm going to go out in this parking lot and there were some guys waiting for me, and I walk out there, but I know that I have Mike Tyson, Evander Holyfield, and I have Rampage, The Rock, and I have all these big old guys. Come on, man, let's go. Let's take these suckers out. No problem, right? Because you know who's coming with you. What's the difference with God? He's bigger than them. Why not walk out and in your battles that you're in right now, Say, I'm here, devil. What you want? What you want? You want to plague my mind? Bring it on. Because the Bible tells me that those that curse you, God will curse them. But those that bless you, God will bless them. So when people put their mouth on you, start lying about you, start talking about you, start talking about your marriage, start talking about your children, God, you got my back, right? Then do what you got to do. That's it. Because you don't have to put your words back on. You don't. All he's trying to do is to influence you to cause problems. That's it. That's all he's trying to do. But if you can trust God, God, you deal with them. Have mercy, God. Have mercy on them. Because I know when I used to put my mouth on people, the stuff you let me go through, no, I don't want them to go through that. Just have mercy on them. Have mercy on them. And you'll see change. You'll see change. You will. So that was part two of the message. We'll do a second closing. All right, so I'm trying to be mindful of the time. I really am. We've had some services that have gone on. What? Yeah. On Wednesday nights, our soakings are intense. Intense. Wednesday night, the Lord told me to teach you guys on Sundays how to soak. The soaking is different than your Sunday service. Sunday services are your religious duties where you come and you sit, you stand, and you clap, you cry. Well, you know, this church, it's like that roller coaster of emotions, the bipolar church, they're crying.
Yeah!
You don't know whether you're going to cry, laugh, or what. And everybody leaves with a headache. Oh my God. What happened? I was in church today. Why do you have a headache? Because I was crying, and then I was laughing, and then I went to laughing and crying. I was all over the place. Right? But in a soaking, you can come in before God, praise Him, lay prostrate before Him, and then He begins to minister to you as you minister up to Him. That's hard on Sundays. That's the truth. Because right now y'all are thinking about the barbecue that you need to turn on. Or the food that's already in the oven. And what needs to go on ice. We'll leave it there. Y'all already knew where I was going. See, shame on y'all. But when you put the Coors Light, you got to make sure the mountains are cold. Then you know. Understand?
Amen.
And when you put the fajitas on the